All right, it's 8 o'clock. We may have some people trickling in, but we'll go ahead and get started. This morning, we're lucky to have Dr. Yingbing Fu, who's going to be talking to us about age-related macular degeneration. He's originally from China, but completed his PhD training at Michigan State, and he's been here at the Moran since 2007. So it sounds like he's going to be talking about a mouse model of age-related macular degeneration and possible implications. His role here at the Moran is he's currently the director for model development at the Translational Medicine here at the Moran Center. So thanks, Dr. Fu, for coming and speaking with us this morning.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I think this is my second time to give grand round presentation at Moran. And mostly I work in the research side, but I also feel that deep in my heart, I'm connected to the clinical side. I still remember when I first came here for a job interview, I asked Robert specifically that I want my office to be on the clinical side, so that at least physically, I'm in the territory of the doctors and the residents. Today I'm going to talk about our research work on HTIA1 and age-related macular degeneration. Most of the results I'm going to present today were published in August, and I also added many new results we obtained very recently. So as all of you know, that AMD is the leading cause of irreversible blindness in the elderly population. By estimate, about 1.75 million people are affected by AMD, and 7 million people are at risk of developing AMD in the U.S., 30 to 50 million people worldwide. So AMD affects the region is the macular. It's really very critical area responsible for high acuity vision, such as reading and driving, and that's why it's so important. If you zoom in this area, there are three important layers, as you can see. The posterior side are called the vascular cell, and this is highly enriched, this layer with cone photoreceptors. In between is the retinal pigment of epithelium or RPE. So any damage occurs in RPE or cone can cause problems in the photoreceptors and cause macular degeneration. So advanced AMD can be separated into dry AMD and wet AMD. The dry AMD is really what happens. Those photoreceptors in the macula slowly break down and start to lose the central vision. It accounts for majority of AMD, and one of the most common early signs of dry AMD is drusen, this yellowish deposit between Bruch's membrane and RPE. So on the other hand, the wet AMD is a very serious form of AMD, and it's really a major cause of vision loss in adults. If you see this healthy macular, I just mentioned there's three layers, photoreceptors, cone photoreceptors, RPEs, and you see the cord vascular is very nicely lying underneath. But if you look at wet AMD, what happens is the cord vessels, they grow, they break the RPE or Bruch's membrane and invade in the subretinal space because the vessels tend to be very fragile and they need fluid, blood, and cause serious damage to the macular region. So there's a variant of wet AMD, so-called polypoidal choroid vasculopathy, or PCV, which was first described by Columbia physician Yanazhi at 1982 as a cause of recurrent hemorrhagic and exudative PD and neurosensory retinal detachment. And there are two key features on indocyanine green angiography, or ICGA. One is a network of branching of normal choroid vessels, the other is polypoidal vascular dilation. I will come back to this later. In terms of demography, it has younger age than exudative AMDs. It's very prevalent in the Asian population, accounts for a quarter to 50% of cases manifesting as exudative AMD, 10% of Caucasian populations. So currently, the pathophysiological mechanism for PCV is unknown. major regions on the chromosome that can account for the majority of genetic risk for AMD. One is on the chromosome loci, 1Q3, it's a well-known complement factor H reach. A number of labs, especially Dr. Hickman's lab, has done major contribution in this discovery. On the other region is on chromosome 10, that's centered around two nearby genes. One is high temperature requirement factor A1 or HGA1. The other is ARMS2, NOC387715. So what do we know about the two genes? The HGA1 is highly conserved all the way from human to E. coli. It belongs to a family of Hitchcock serine proteins involved in many functions such as protein quantity control, cell growth differentiation, and apoptosis. So in humans, we have HGA1, 2, 3, 4. You can see the 1, 3, 4 are very similar. They were ubiquitously expressed. HGA2 is mainly in mitochondria. One common feature is that they have a system-like Krebs domain, and also on the C-terminal, as a PGZ is a protein-protein interaction domain, and the N-terminal is a causal-type protein inhibitor domain, suggesting that the enzyme may be self-inhibiting, and it also has an insulin growth factor binding domain, and they have a signal sequence that allows the proteins to be secreted out of cells. So malfunction of HGA1 was implicated in a number of diseases, such as cancer, neuromuscular disorder, Alzheimer's disease, arthritis, and aging. Just reminding you, this is through genetic association studies, HGA1 has been linked to both PCV and CNVs, and also other types of AMDs. In contrast to HGA1, very little is known about ARMS2, other than that it's a primate-specific transcript. It's not in all the primates, made in old world monkeys with a proposed function in mitochondria, but even that is in dispute right now. So it's not entirely clear whether it's really meaningful of protein or not. So in contrast to chromosome 1 region, pretty much most people agree that the complement factor H plays a very important role. There's a great deal of controversy surrounding the two competing candidates. There are three major hypotheses. The first one is that increased protein level HGA1 is responsible for increased risk for AMD. The second major hypothesis is that decreased level ARMS2 is responsible for the increased risk of AMD. The third one is a combination of both. So it's a binary model, basically claim both increased HGA1 and decreased ARMS2 are responsible for AMD risk. You can always see it's getting quite confusing. The reason for this great deal of controversy is that the two genes are very close to each other on the chromosome 10 region. ARMS2 and HGA1, right each other. And these are the several famous SNPs in this region. In other words, all those SNPs are in tight linkage with equilibrium, makes genetic association studies very difficult to distinguish the two candidates. And this is a well-known initial insertion polymorphism here shows a decreased level of ARMS2. Okay, since the studies on the genetic association studies, I should say that has been replicated in almost all ethnic groups in the world. So the genetic association studies obviously very strong on the contribution of chromosome 10 region to AMD risk. But however, afterwards, a number of labs trying to determine the functional involvement of the chromosome 10 region and get lots of difficulties. For example, the deletion insertion polymorphism, as I mentioned, was shown to decrease the expression of ARMS2, but at the same time, increase the expression of HGA1. So it makes you wonder which one is more important. And there's another polymorphism that encodes an early stop called R38H in ARMS2. It's actually associated with a protective or non-risk haplotype. Was shown by a number of labs that in direct conflict with the idea that decrease in level ARMS2 is associated with increased risk of AMD. And finally, the very recent paper published by Weber's group in Germany, the strongest supporter of ARMS2, they concede that currently unknown mechanisms mediate pathogenic effect of the risk associated variants at the chromosome 10 region. Okay. So when we come to this project, think, okay, the genetic study is quite difficult. Then we decided to take a functional approach by using animal models. That's our expertise. So the idea is quite straightforward. We decided to transgenic express human FGFR1 in mouse RP, and we ask a simple question, will the transgenic mice exhibit any AMD phenotypes at all? The reason we can do that is that the human and the mouse FGFR1 are highly conserved. Both of them have 480 amino acids with 91% identical. If you look at the domains, they are almost the same. Protease domain, very similar PDC domain, inhibitor domain. So what we predicted is that the human FGFR1, when we put it into the mouse, will interact whatever the endogenous interaction partners of the mouse FGFR1. So we generated the transgenic mice, and we started characterizing them. First, look at their expressions. So let's look at the message enabled by real-time RT-PCR. You can see the FGFR1 was specifically expressed in the mouse RP, not in the retina, liver, heart, or skins. And if you look at Western blot, the proteins we can detect in the transgenic, but not in the wild-type liver mice. We're also trying to quantify the expression level of human FGFR1 in the mouse RP. So this is by using the purified human recombinant human FGFR as standard. And then we compare this from human donor eyes, RP tissues, and the transgenic mouse RP. The bottom line, the expression is about 5.3 times higher than in the normal human RP tissues. Also, we did immunohistochemistry trying to locate the human FGFR in the mouse. It's located mostly in the basal side of RP and also in the choroid. So that is consistent with the FGFR1 being a protein that mainly secreted out of cells into the actual cellular matrix. Okay, so now we have generated transgenic mice. Now the important question is, do these mice have any AMD-like phenotypes? So we use a number of techniques. The in vivo imaging is actually exactly the same used by ophthalmologists to examine AMD patients. The fluorescent angiography, ICGA, fundus image, OCT, even the machines, the Heidelberg spectrometer is same as used for patient's diagnosis. And of course, with the mouse model, the added advantage is we can do a pretty good histology to look at the artery structures. Okay, this is just to remind you that in the human and the mouse, there are two vascular beds, the choroid vessels and the inner retina vessels. So the FA is because the emission in the green fluorescence cannot penetrate the RP, so mainly you will see the retina vessel structure. The ICG is because the infrared emissions, they can penetrate through the RP, you will see both the retina vessels and the choroid vessels, where the OCT, of course, give you in vivo cross-section. So the mouse OCT is the inverted imaging. So we did first check the wild-type liver mice. As you can see, the machines actually allow us to focus from the anterior side to the posterior side. But the bottom line is both the FAs and the ICGAs are normal as you expected. So then when we start to examine the transgenic mice, the FA is pretty normal, I would say. So that suggests the retinal vessels are okay. But when we start to look at ICGAs, even starting from the anterior side, you start to see some lesions, you know. When we focus more toward the posterior side, you can start seeing more lesions, some bigger ones, some small ones, more and more clear. So I still remember the student Alex Jones when he first got his result. He was so excited. He ran out of the vivarium trying to find me. And I don't know what it is, because with my limited knowledge at that time, all I was thinking AMD is the CNV, which is the same lesion FA, but why is FA is normal? And ICG, I saw these lesions. So I called up Tor and Bana and asked them what happened, and both of them suggested that they resemble the PCV in human. So this is a composite ICG angiography, which show you almost like three-dimensional structures. You can see the wild types are normal structures, but in transgenic, you see the wide distribution of the lesions. So just, right, so this is a more severe phenotype. Let's also show you another picture, show you really stunning resolution on the vessels. You can see lots of lesions distributed throughout the choroid vasculature. Just to remind you, the mouse eye is tiny compared with human eyes. So To get this kind of resolution with mouse eye is quite challenging. The student did an outstanding job. Okay, so when we start zooming in on the bigger lesions, if you look carefully, it's not really a bigger lesion per se, but it consists of many smaller dots or looks like really grip cluster-like structure on the branch. So it's very typical for polypoidal lesions. If you look at the human PCV patient on ICG. Also, we look at some abnormal choroid vessels branching network. You can see there's no structure with lesion in the center, very similar to human PCV patient. In other words, the mouse exhibit this phenotype on ICG, which fit very well with two key definitions of the human PCV. And also on the fundoscopy, you can see wild type is pretty normal. On the transgenic mice, we can also see this yellow deposit. And they locate actually the same location, most of them, on ICG lesion, suggesting it's probably exudate from the choroid vessels. This in the human PCV patients. Okay, so more recently, although with the all those mice, I should say, are on pigmented background, mostly on the black 6 background, very popular background. So with the ICGA, you can see the lesions, the bright lesions, but still you cannot see very well the vessel structures of the choroid. I mean, most of the vessels in the retina still are much more clear on the mouse. So to get around this problem, we decided to take another approach, is to breed all those mice into the CD1 is albino background, which give you much better resolution on the choroid vessel. So this one, because the way we focus on it, we are pretty confident majority of them are actually choroid vessels. And in the wild type, it shows very normal structure. Okay, so when we start to see the transgenic mice, you see very interesting, we showed a couple of them, it seems weird, this branching pattern, and also some really damaged vessels. And you can also see a number of this abnormal structure. So we'll allow you to see much more clear, give you much better resolution than on the black 6 background. So we are still in the process of analyzing them, also in combination with EMs to see the ultra structures. We also found there's a great deal of phenotype variation. Some of transgenic mouse has a very weak phenotype with a few lesions. Some of them have a moderate phenotype, some of them have very severe phenotype. You can see there's many lesions, some bigger, some smaller ones. So we also found there's a great deal of variation in terms of phenotype progression. This is a mouse at 2 months of age. You can see the lesions, when we examine 3 months later, there's not a huge change, I would say, pretty quiescent. But if you look at the other one, it's 7 months of age, but 3 months later, there are far more lesions in the head. So it's kind of pretty active. And we also found that there's a great deal of influence of genetic background on the phenotypes. We examined, at that time, about 114 transgenic mice. Out of them, 67 showed PCV phenotype, we call them PCV plus. Well, the other 47 did not, so we call them PCV negative. If we took the PCV positive mice bred with the wild type black 6, out of them, majority of them, 78% developed PCV. However, if we took the PCV negative mice and bred with black 6, majority of them don't have phenotypes. Only 28% developed PCV. So pretty obvious that genetic background has an influence on this. And in the beginning, we were thinking maybe the expression level of HTR1 is different in the different mice, but actually turns out not the case. So you can see in both PCV positive, PCV negative mice have exact same level of HTR1 expression, suggesting there's other factors inside the mouse modulating HTR1 activity. And that's actually pretty interesting. We are trying to determine what is it, what are those factors. So I will come back to this. On the internet. And the other question is, most of these mice, when we examine them, are in adulthood. So the question is, because the FGR1 transient expressions turned down very early on, so the question is, do those mice have normal choroid vessels in the beginning? Maybe it's a developmental issue. Maybe all those vessels were screw up in the very early stage. How do we know? Right, so just to remind you that For mouse eyes, they don't open their eyes until about 2 weeks age, so about P14 days. And even that age, the mouse, it's kind of difficult also to image them. So again, we use the image optimized on the albino background, it's much easier. So the P14 wild type, you can see a picture not the best one because the mouse eyes pretty smart, they just open their eyes. But we can tell not normal wild type transgenic mice, we don't see huge differences. We image a couple of them. But a few days later, about P19 days, you can see the wild type still normal, but in the transgenic mice, you can already see type of So based on this, it suggests that those mice have normal choroid vessels to begin with, but later with the constant accumulation secretion of FGFR1 from RPs, they start to have these problems. So we are trying to now doing EMs and histology trying to confirm this. We also did OCTs trying to locate the lesions, but based on FAs, ICG, we can guess Nash is located in the choroid vessels, but it's indeed the case. So for physicians, just to remind you, this is an inverted image. So it's probably is neither different from when you took the human OCTs. But anyway, so there's ICG lesions mostly located beneath the posterior side of the RP, mainly in the choroid. Okay, so with the mouse, we can do systematically look for the histologies. And there's a transgenic mice. One thing is actually staining. Very striking is we always see pool of red blood cells accumulated between the RP and the choroid. Very rarely seen in the wild type. And we think those were due to leakage from the compromised choroid vessels. And if we cut ultra thin plastic sections, about 200 nanometer, we always see a cluster of very thin wall choroid vessels, and you don't see them in the wild type. So this is the EM structure on the choroid, this artery. This is a cross section of the artery, you can see. Very nice new wall, very layered, you can zoom in, all the layers are quite intact from the mesenium, synaptic, internal, to the lentitia. But if you look at the transgenic mice, look at the artery, look at how thin it is. You know? And if you zoom in this area, it's very striking, both the synaptic, internal, completely disappeared. And tunica media severely degenerated. Okay, so there are also great similarities between the transgenic mice and the human PCV in terms of histopathology. You can see the same vessel we show you on transgenic mice and the choroid vessels, and in human PCV patients, you can always see also those very similar choroid vessel walls. The other thing is we look at the retina vasculature, this is by Flammon staining with isonectin. So you can see largely the transgenic mice are pretty normal, you know, vascular on the retina vessel. This is consistent with the imaging which I showed you that earlier, the FA is quite normal, and also that the fact with immunohistochemistry we have shown HGR1 was secreted out from the basal side of RP for the choroid. We don't see much of the secretion to the other side, which is to the for the retina. So I should say that most of the transgenic mice don't really have a classical CMV cases because the FA is quite normal. But in some of very old ones, they develop something looks like occult CMV. You can see that on the more than 11 months old, on the transgenic mice, you can see this speckled hypofluorescence, and also this ICGA. We're also trying to look for whether there's correlation between PCV severities and occult type CMVs. Turns out they don't have really a direct correlation. For example, you can see some of them have very severe PCV phenotype, but they don't have any occult CMV whatsoever. The FA is completely normal. So what do we think is, it seems there are different factors control the development of the two type or subtype of wild type AMD. And another very prominent feature of the transgenic mice is the degradation of the elastic lamina of the Bruch's membrane. So let me show you on the wild type, this is the choroid side of the RP, this is the beta-infoldment. And this is the Bruch's membrane. In the center, this is the very thick nightmare of the last millennium. And you can transient mice, you can see very striking. There are lots of disruption of gas here. And I'll show you another picture here. The Brooks membrane really consists of five layers, base membrane, choroid, outer connecting layer, inactive lamina, inner connecting layer, base membrane are depleted out here. And if you look at the transgenic mice, very striking is that there's not stress of inactive lamina here. However, other layer becomes intact. So this is very selective degradation of the inactive lamina. We also quantify the integrity of the EL. And let me just show you that the definition of the integrity of the EL is that the tutor length of the EL divided by tutor length of Brooks membrane. In other words, if it's 100%, that means there's no gap whatsoever. So in a wild type, it's pretty good, it's about 95%. In a transgenic mice, decrease significantly to about 64%. PCV length is much better, about 90%. If you look at the combined gap length, the PCV positive have 390, almost 90 microns, compared about 36 microns of wild type, so almost 9 times bigger gaps. And the PCV negative is also much better. So this is pretty exciting to us because earlier work by Dr. Hitterman's team shows very nicely that in both early AMD and CMAs, there's a decreased thickness and integrity of the macular elastic layer, you can see here, compared with the controls. So the idea is that layer is very important, or perhaps as a protective barrier to prevent CMV formations. And we think maybe one reason or mechanism for this breakdown of the EL in this region is due to FGF1 activity. Okay, so far I have shown you that in the transgenic mice, there are two prominent features. One is the degradation of the choroid vessels. The other is the degradation of the EL of the Brooks membrane. For both of them, a very straightforward explanation is due to the activity of HTLA1. However, it was not shown before the HTLA1 has elastic activity, so we did this in vitro assays. What we did is purified recombinant human HTLA1 and used quint fluorescent labeled inactin as a substrate. And this is a control which is pancreatic inactase. You can see the HTLA1 indeed has inactase activity, but the activity is much, much lower, the basal activity, about 30 times lower than the typical inactase. By the way, Dr. Hickman's team also have the same result. So we also come back to examine the transgenic mice because if that's the case, we should see some degraded inactin in vivo. So indeed, that's the case. If we talk to mice, if we connect to mice, also transgenic. So undetected with antibody against proper inactin, which is really the basic building block for the insoluble inactin nature. So you can see that there's increased degradation of inactin in the PCV positive and not in the wild type, nor in the PCV negative. Okay, so because the basal activity of a human HTLA1 is so low, the question is that sufficient to explain the severe phenotype we observe? Just reminding you, the HTLA1 is quite a complex molecule, has quite a few domains. It has been shown previously that both the N-terminal is a causal type inhibitor domain and the C-terminal PTZ domain regulates HTLA1 activity. It kind of inhibits their activity. And that may explain why the basal activity of HTLA1 is quite low. And also, the removal of the inhibitor domain or binding of PTZ domain can activate HTLA1 protein activity by more than threefold with a combined effect of ninefold. Okay, so what we think what happened is that because the basal activity is so low, there must be some other extracellular matrix proteins are involved in activating HTLA1 and producing the PCV phenotypes. That may explain why the variations of phenotypes we observe. May also explain white Asians has higher prevalence with PCVs, while the Caucasians have lower prevalence. So in addition to the two main features I just showed you, we also observed photoreceptor degeneration and RP atrophies in the transgenic mice. You can see in the wild type, there's an RP structure, very nice organized out segment piece in the segment, but disorganized in transgenic mice, also in the segment are more vacuous. The wild type, you can see very nice structure RPs, okay? But in the transgenic mice, you can see that some of the area is basal encoding here, and then you can also see vacuous, the basal linear deposit to be associated with early AMDs, and also there are some motor gaps. I always show you in the year, I was interested in that you can see in the senior interlinear processes in this gap. So on the other hand, with the PCV negative match, they have the transient, but they are pretty normal. When we look at their histology and arterial structure, they are also quite normal. Actually, screening is pretty okay. If you look at arterial structure, they have nice choroid vessels, photoreceptors are nice, and we don't see lots of disruption on the EL. Because the VEGF plays a very significant role in the progression or in the CNV development. So we also examine the VEGF expression in the transgenic mice to see that in both PCV positive and negative, has increased VEGF levels, also by immunohistochemistry to show in the RP layers. Because it's increasing both the PCV positive and negative mice, what we think is that increased HR seems to lead to upregulation of VEGF in RP and the choroid. We are still trying to determine the mechanism for this. However, we think that VEGF elevation itself is not sufficient to induce PCVs, although it's critical for PCV CNV pathogenesis. That may explain the relatively less effective treatment of anti-VEGF for PCVs in comparison with very effective treatment for the CNVs. Okay, so let me summarize what I have talked to you so far. What we conclude is that we show that by increasing the expression level of HTR1 in the mouse, it's sufficient to cause PCV phenotype. And because the degradation in the Bruch's membrane, and also the elevation of VEGF is also a significant risk factor for CNVs. Okay. So more recently, based on this mechanism, and also about the mouse model, we're trying to develop some preventive and treatment strategy, trying to, for both PCV and the CNV, by targeting the HTR1 molecule. So the idea is to take this very potent peptide inhibitor. This was first developed by Michael Ehrman's group at Germany. So this is published pretty recently in 2011. So what they did is they crystallized the catalytic domain of human HTR1. It's in complex with this inhibitor. It's pretty much irreversible inhibitor binds on this three key residues in the catalytic site. Okay. And the challenge is because remember, in the mouse model we developed, the most occurred in the choroid vessels. The challenge is how to deliver the inhibitor into the posterior side in the choroid. The way we're trying to figure out this out is to use nanoparticles has a sustained release delivery and by intravitreal injection. So I want to go through all the literature, but quite a few studies to show that by this way you can have the RP take up the nanoparticles pretty nicely, and you can have sustained release anywhere between weeks to months. Okay, so the nanoparticle was prepared by John Rainier at the chemistry department, and we did transmission EM, just look at those are the nanoparticles. Remember, the inside, they don't absorb lots of electron density, they're not much electron density, so you can see almost like a hole in the meter, but the average diameter is about 18 nanometer. And then we did intravitreal injections. The nanoparticle was encapsulating this coumarin dye, fluorescent dye, so we can visualize it. It's controlled 4 days after injection. You can see very nicely they go up to the junction between RP and our segment or the photoreceptor layers. And this is still quite preliminary. We just got this data recently. So we inject a few transgenic mice with the PCV phenotype. Before injection, we took the ICGAs. The control mice was injected with nanoparticles plus the quinine dye, but the other eye was injected with nanoparticles plus the peptide inhibitors and the coumarin dye. So you can see with the control injection, we don't see much change after 15 days if you can look at ICG lesions. But with the inhibitors, we can see a decrease of the lesions. So we still need to replicate it with more mice, but it's kind of encouraging, very encouraging to us. Just remind you, currently, the treatment for PCV is quite limited. So there's, you can do, I think, as far as I know, you can do thermodynamic treatment and also in combination with anti-VEGF. But in most cases, that you can reduce the exudations, but the lesions, most cases, they remain very, very resistant. And also, this, I think it's pretty difficult rescue, because what we ask is, I show you in the actual structure, there's a severe degeneration on the choroid vessel walls. So not only we have to stop the constant insult by the FTR1, but also we ask the vessels to repair itself. The other way we are currently doing now is that trying to prevent, so that is to inject inhibitors before the mouse develop any PCV phenotypes to see how long or how much we can actually delay the onset of the phenotype. So the implication is that maybe by doing so, with in the future, if people have the have carried the polymorphism in the chromosome 10 region, maybe we can give them inhibitor to prevent it from occurring. So the implications I just show you that what we think is the inositol activity of FGFR1 seems to play a very prominent role in AMD risk. And we also show you a likely pathophysiological mechanism for PCV development. I also go through that we are trying to develop some preventive and treatment strategies by using the mouse models and to target the FGFR1 molecules. We also think that our results may explain why the genetic variants and the chromosome 10 region are preferentially associated with the wild type AMD. And also may explain why the progression of wild AMD is strongly correlated with increased inositol degradation that has been shown by a number of labs, especially in the serum. You know, you can detect that degraded inositol pretty well. Maybe one factor is due to FGFR1. So I will not go through all of them, but this is really trying to address the mechanism. Prevention and therapy, I already mentioned. But one exciting project we are doing now is trying to generate a primate models of AMD, really based on the success that on the mouse models. And this is done in collaboration with a number of labs, Dr. Hagerman, Paul, and Sandro's lab. The reason is, for the simple reason that you cannot really develop a true AMD model with mouse because they don't have a mechanism there. If you know the macaque here. So if we can develop a really primate AMD model in terms of both study the mechanism and treatment, it is, I think, is a huge step forward. Okay, so most of the work was done by very talented student Alex Jones, postdoc Sandeep Kumar, and other people in the lab. Robert Mark's lab has really been instrumental in the EM studies. Bana Nino has been very helpful on in vivo imaging. Dr. Hickman, Paul, and Sandra are involved in the primate project. And Kanda has been involved in the early phase of the project. I don't have time to talk about Chair Ocker, but she provided us the HTR1 knockout mice. Okay, thank you. I'll be happy to answer your questions.
Human genetics, and this is my information, Lisa, so new in that you haven't even
understand the question, but remember, a transgenic mice we designed is to really express very specific only to the eye, targeted eye. So they are not expressing other tissues. So we don't expect they have others. But the other mouse model we are trying to develop is trying to, with systemic expression of HIV.
That's the next step. Yeah.
Right, that's
so
the next
you get
step.
An important point, that's
yeah,
the
point. So that's a good point.
And, I mean, I just think partnering with somebody in somebody's lab that could take these mice, the rest of their brains and
right.
blood vessels and everything, look at some of that would be really, really interesting. So I help us understand why the preeclampsia, et cetera, because there are choroid-like blood vessels elsewhere that are really important to help the kidney and so.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point, because in humans, the FGFR actually is widely expressed. So it's a very special case of trying to express in RP, so just to make it convenient to develop phenotype, but you are off to the right. So I'm trying to do this, have a systemic expression, so you can have wide tissue distributions. And the one concern is you may have very low survival rate, we don't know what happened. So we want to do this, the other way is to get around this with inducible promoters. So we can get around the developmental stage, we can turn down later at adult level and to examine the phenotypes.
And I have one more. Did you use any kind of, try these mice on vitamins or some kind of protective agent besides the HTR-A1?
That's the next one. We have tried a few experiments, but the student just get recently, so I don't have time to think, but it's very exciting is that if we took those mice and put on oxidative stress, so for example, one thing we do is we took those, give them very bright light, cause light-induced oxidative stress. And what happened is those PCV negative mice, quote unquote, we saw, start to develop PCVs. So pretty clear, when you give them oxidative stress, you make it worse. And then for the treatment, nutrition supplement, and that's in the future. Yeah.
Beautiful talk. I have two questions. The PCV positive mice versus the PCV negative mice.
Okay.
The PCV positive mice have produced blastocysts and produced photosensitive mice.
So we haven't looked. So in terms,
he's got this one where he shows that the PCV negative does not have the same elastase degeneration as the PCV positive.
Right. So we still on outer structures, so the Bruch's membrane coiled vessel now put intact.
So right. The EO is kind of the elastase activity.
So we haven't the in vivo elastase activity is very difficult, right? Okay, because the FGFR never is pretty low, but if you we did a Western to show that we do see increased degradations in elastin in the PCV positive, but not in the PCV negative. So maybe not a direct answer. But that's a good point. The other way we're trying to do is to do microarray analysis to compare the gene expressions of multiple genes between PCV and PCV negative and to say what are the differences. Maybe they give some ideas about what factors are modulating FGFR1 activity. If that's the case, that means in some patients, or maybe we can explore in this, take advantage of this by designing specific factors to inhibit FGFR activity or to modulate FGFR activity. That's one. The photoreceptors are pretty okay in the PCV negative.
Okay.
Yeah, they are pretty okay.
So PCV positive.
Right.
You
can see here. The one about 80 to 100 nanometers.
100 nanometers.
Oh no, you mean the diameter of nanoparticle? Yeah, in the diameter of nanoparticle, I think I still show a transmission EM. It's about 80 to 100 nanometers diameter. Right. Oh, you mean the distribution?
Yeah.
Oh, they cross very well. We did a number of injections, so they can always reach to the RP and yeah, they can use it pretty well. I think there are other people show that around 100, 120, 150 nanometer, they can cross pretty well. Yeah, that's a good question. So one way generally transgenic mice is on a mixed background, is on the CBA, Flex6, whatever used by the transgenic core facility. And in the gold standard in the field is that you have back cross with Flex6 for 10 generations. I mean, we DNAs, I mean, we obviously we're trying to cross them, but so all the phenotype we show is in the early stage, five generations. So we know they start from mixed backgrounds. And then what we want to know is the discussion with Dr. Hickman last month. So he is very keen to develop the transgenic mice in the pure background. So the idea that I talk with the transgenic core facility with Susan, he said it's possible either on the pure Flex6 or CD1 backgrounds. It is possible. So it's much easier to inject to a pure background with the pseudo modules. Then start off with 10 generation breeding takes forever. It takes very long time. Yeah, that's a good question. But we start from the mixed backgrounds, you know, or those mice. Yeah. Right. So there's very little, as far as you can tell, there are not many studies to address why the Asians and the Caucasians have different incidence of PCVs. And there definitely is a genetic factor, but people don't know. You know. We're trying to do this in the microarray assays on the mice to say maybe give us some hint. If we find some interesting genes, we can go back to the human genetics. That's the idea. You know. So that's the other approach. We're trying to develop some shRNAs, deliver by plasmids, or use virus. Yeah, that's one.
And then you were talking about the, you know, developing a pure PCB plus count strain. Would it be possible to develop a PCB minus count strain that overexpressed HTR and didn't develop the phenotype? And then that, those two would be good models.
Right, so to develop PCV negative one is more challenging because so far, when we put either a Flex6 or CD1 background, we have to see. That part is hard to tell, you know, until we do the experiment.
But it's a great concept.
Yeah,
you know,
it's good.
Question.
Yeah.
That would be very interesting to try to understand. The difference is there. You got to figure out why it's there.
Actually, when I talk with my students, said that we want to develop the transgenic mice on pure background, so it's pure PCV positive. They say, oh, we like PCV negative. You know, what are you doing here? Yes, definitely.